letters that spell.
They had a certain something.
Nas with the boy wonder.
He spoke the language of the ghetto.
Disciple, my raps are trifle. I shoot slugs from my brain just like a rifle.
You'd have to be brain dead not to know that that kid was a genius.
They chased one goal relentlessly.
I'll never forget this. He said, I want to be a rapper.
I know I can.
He said, you know, I want it all.
Through struggles,
Nasir's best friend, Willie Grant, wound up getting shot.
One of the dudes pulled out a gun and shot him 3 times in the back.
I really expected Nasir to just go straight downhill from there.
And setbacks.
His mom was real ill.
I just remembered her constantly encouraging him to work hard and, you know, not to worry about her. He knew that he had to do that for her.
Let's go!
Some people are just driven. A young MC's defiant pursuit of superstardom.
Hey. He decided to distance himself away from everything that was going to keep him from his ultimate goal.
He said, yo, it's either music or I'm going down. There's no other exit out.
Never before seen images, stories, and revelations from the people who know what really happened.
Nas was being attacked.
The Jay-Z disc came from left field.
I was like, damn, Nas, like, damn, they're over.
Brace yourself for the main event.
Because they lived it with him.
Nas came back and he spoke his mind. Check it out.
Put your soul like ether. He stood up like a man and faced it. It was about, yo, I'm Nas, dog. You a fan, a phony, a fake. Don't forget who I am.
This is Driven, Nas.
The A to the
S-I-R. Nasir Jones was born September 14, 1973 at Brooklyn Jewish Hospital.
Yo, the world is yours.
As a baby, I can always remember Nas always having a smile on his face, always looking like he's up to something. I do think that it was something about him where he kind of stood out.
Check me out, y'all.
Everybody seemed to be drawn to him.
This is a journey into the world's most largest and notorious project. Queensbridge.
We moved to Queensbridge when Nas was 3 or 4 years old.
This is the place where stars are born.
Queensbridge is located right across the river from Manhattan. Keep on rocking the bridge, we'll keep rocking. It's the largest project in the world and about 10,000 residents in total. You know the block was ill
as a youngster. We grew up with bullets and, you know, crack, you know, just saw people shoot heroin in their arms. This is
crazy. Queensbridge projects was so dangerous that you were definitely hearing gunshots every night.
While the shots going off and you're in your house, you're like, damn, somebody don't got killed.
It can be very bad for children. Will it take me under? But it can also be a wonderful place to grow up. Imagine that. Depending on how much of a family structure is there.
The Jones apartment was a really warm, comfortable, cozy type place to be in. It was just like a family atmosphere.
My family was always very tight-knit.
Nas and his mother were very close. I thought his personality was a lot like hers. They're both very quiet people, very giving people. I wouldn't say he was a mama's boy, but most people probably would.
Nasir's musical influences were coming directly from his father.
I was trying to make a living with music. I collected instruments from all over the world. I had trumpets, guitars, keyboards.
African instruments, xylophones, like all kinds of stuff.
Got the music playing.
A lot of young musicians would be in my house constantly. People come out off the road, stop by to see me, play instruments, talk music.
Jazz, bebop to rapping.
We used to pick all the instruments up and play with them, blow it, you know, break them and get in trouble over it, you know.
Nas was very adept to playing musical instruments. Anything he touched, he could play. He started playing trumpet around 2. At the age of 3 or 4, he played outside on the stoops and he drew crowds every day in the afternoons. It was an unusual thing to happen to me, the father, you know, just listening to your son play horn like that with no lessons, and he's only 3 or 4 years old. But I stopped him from playing because his lip was getting very relaxed and droopy. And he was very upset. And he never wanted to play an instrument again. But he's always looking to do something creative. That was his whole thing. So he started writing and illustrating short stories like comic books and making up his own comic books.
He'll draw a comic book
like just like a DC comic book or a Marvel comic book with its own characters, own storyline, all kinds of people in it, all kinds of villains and everything.
The Incredible Hulk was a favorite of his, and Spider-Man. He would always write stories about them, but he would always change the attitude and the persona of the character, I guess, to reflect what he saw outside.
The next thing you know, he would start writing lyrics, playing around with hip-hop lyrics. He must have been about 7 or 8 years old.
Now, I've always had pencil and paper. I just remember always finding rhymes laying around somewhere.
Nas and some of the guys in the neighborhood were just beginning to rap. And they were rapping over my tapes of ancient African music. And Nas was flooring like he had been doing it since birth. It was a beautiful thing to hear.
Back in 83, I was an MC sparking, but I was too scared to grab the mics in the box.
But he didn't want to rhyme in front of crowds of people in the projects.
He was always more comfortable in his, you know, familiar surroundings.
His mother was very much in love with Olu, and I think he was in love with her, but, you know, musicians are never good husbands.
She needs a man around to help raise those kids at all times. I couldn't do it because I had to travel around the world and make money as a musician.
There were times when Ann had to deal with, you know, Olu having other women in his life.
Papa was a player. Player was a papa. Papa loved the ladies.
My father was cheating too much. He cheated and he got caught.
Running around town. Don't tell your mother what's going red.
It's hard to balance personal life with a life as a musician.
If they stay together, then someone will get killed.
They used to argue all the time, and one day my mother couldn't take it. It was just over.
When I left, things got very, very hard. Nas was 13 years old.
It crushed him a whole lot when, you know, Olu left.
It made Nas serious, like, you know, from laughing all the time and running around, we got a little serious after that. Once my father left the crib, it was just me, Nas, and my mother.
She was working hard, working these long hours, trying to provide a way for them so that they could stay off of the streets.
She dedicated her whole life for the kids. Like, she didn't go to the movies, she didn't go out to eat. She just went to work, came home, and dealt with the kids.
If she didn't breathe, it didn't matter, as long as her children were breathing. Her focus was to always instill in them self-confidence. You know, she never let Nasir ever think that he couldn't do anything.
His mom had high expectations for Nasir, and she understood that in order for him to be successful, he would need an education.
I just remember there being one philosophy in the household. That was the Ann Jones philosophy. You went to school.
That, to her, was the ultimate achievement, something that focused her upbringing for Nasir, especially because he was so intelligent.
My mother just wanted him to be somebody in life.
But Nasir was a person who never really liked school, and he never wanted to do it.
He was the type that could pick up on anything. He didn't have to study, but he was just turned off from it.
Him and some of his other friends, they hooked school, and the more they did it, the more they wanted to do it.
He might miss a day, and then it turned into 3 days. Turned into weeks, a month.
Cut out of class just to smoke, once to drink.
One day, him and his mother was having a discussion about him going to school. And he was going back, no, I don't want to go to school, I don't want to go to school. I mean, it was nose to nose. He was really in his mother's face, and she was really back at him.
And after that, he just didn't go to school anymore.
Nas was 14, dropped out of the ninth grade.
I knew that his mom was devastated.
Ann was very concerned about Nas not slipping into street life.
Most kids, when they stop going to school, they start selling drugs.
When he dropped out, it was like kind of critical, you know what I'm saying? Because you had to know what you was going to do after that.
He was in the project slipping, you know, like just hanging out in the hood. My mother, she worried that one day he could get shot or killed.
She didn't want him to go to jail, you know, she didn't want him to die. And he was just surrounded by all of that.
Word. Nas dropped out of high school, you know, just chilling on the block.
My mother was very disappointed when Nas dropped out of school.
It broke her heart.
She didn't want him to get caught up in the traps, the being the projects and stuff like that.
He was hanging a lot in the Bridge. That's where his family was, that's where his friends were, that's what he was connected to.
He was running with Willie Graham, a.k.a. Ill Will.
Ill Will, Willie Graham. He lived on the 6th floor, and we lived on 5D, you know, right underneath each other.
And Nas was very close to him.
I don't remember seeing them apart at all. And almost anything they did, if my brother would go somewhere, Nas would be right with him.
Their common goal was like music, you know?
Nasir and Willie were going to be, you know, Run DMC, you know, the tag team. Willie was on the turntables and Nasir was going to rhyme.
Nas always talked to Wilson, yo, we're gonna make it, we're gonna get out the hood, you know what I'm saying? So that was their dream that they had.
He looked at me and just told me, I'm going to be a rapper and everyone's going to love my music. I'm gonna change the whole game. Take this whole over and be the man.
And then Nas just went to another level on the rhyme tip. You know what I mean? He just went to another level.
He just started flowing. I mean, his flow was just so different from what everybody else was doing. Rappers are monkey flipping with the funky rhythm. I be
kicking, musician, and flipping composition. Back then, people wasn't really putting big words in their raps yet. But Nas was all into the re-in and all into, you know, changing the vocabulary of the hip-hop.
The way he put his rhyme was like, you couldn't have guessed that he dropped out of the ninth grade. I'm taking rappers to a new plateau. Do rap slow.
My rhyming is a vitamin. Hell without a capsule. He did a lot of self-teaching. He read all day, all the time.
I mean, doctor books, language books, law books.
He used to read the dictionary. He used to read a full dictionary. Well, acapella rhymes that make me richer
than a slipper made Cinderella fella. You know, Nas was coming out with words like cranium and crazy stuff that nobody in the hood really, really never heard of them words, like, you know what I'm saying?
He just was the smartest street rapper in the hood. Yeah. One time for your mind, one time. If he started freestyling, we would just close our eyes, you know, and we could see the whole thing.
His mother's response to him saying he wanted to be a rapper was, oh, I can't believe this. You know, she threw her hands in the air because it was like, of all the things, why a rapper?
But she knew, you know, this is my son. This is what he wants to do. I know he's talented. I'm going to support him.
When she knew that he wanted to be in the music business, she just said, all right, I'm going to just help you then.
She was the one who gave him the money to put together his demos and that kind of thing.
I watched her give him $60. And I used to say, why did you give him? I thought you didn't have no money. And she used to be like, he's going to the studio.
Nas wanted to get into the studio and do a little demo or whatever. And his brain was like, yo, my man, Lost Professor, probably hook you with a beat.
At the time, Large Professor was one of the hottest producers around in the game.
He was working out of a studio called Power Play Studios, and Nas was just a kid from Queensbridge who would walk up the block to the studio trying to get put on. So Large came in there, and Nas is rapping, you know? Yo, they call me Nas, I'm not your legal type of fella. Now I'm drinking, and I'm over, I ain't smoking street dweller. And Large was like, yo, Ock, this kid from Queensbridge, he's pretty dope.
Nas
is a rebel
of the street corner. Nas was only 17 when he hooked up with Large Professor. The timing was perfect for Nas because Large Professor was about to record this album, Breaking Atoms, with his group Main Source that was going to feature a whole bunch of artists.
We're nobodies just coming out of nowhere trying to make, you know, history. And we guest starred on Large Professor's album on a song called Live at the Barbecue. Let me say ho!
It gave Nas his shot, man, and it just was on from there. I work fantastic, realistic, my raps are drastic, not simplistic. Nas spit one verse on Live at the Barbecue. Sometimes that's all it takes is one verse. Street's disciple, my raps are trifle.
I shoot slugs from my brain just like a rifle. Street's disciple, my raps are trifle.
I shoot slugs from my brain just like a rifle. Stampede the stage, I leave the microphone split.
Clean is the toughie while I'm on some pretty tones.
When I was 12, I went to Hell for Snuffin' Jesus. I'm sorry, that's just genius. Rap radioactive, attractive, hyperactive,
I drop bombs, my rhymes are massive. That one verse did it, you know what I mean? That was the knockout punch, the like blow to the gut right there where the people just fell on the floor, you know? And they were like, wow.
Everything was just completely disgustingly ill on the lyrical side. Yeah, you're stepping at me, you'd rather step to the whole world. I was just like, this dude is gonna be the next dangerous thing to happen to hip hop.
After Live at the Barbecue, everybody was just like, yo, who's that? Who's that?
Nas was the biggest talk of New York City.
He was the guy that everybody wanted on their record. Like, the second you heard him, but you couldn't find him.
He wasn't out. Like, he wasn't networking. He wasn't politicking.
Live at the barbecue, creates this buzz for Nas, but it's not like you get paid mad paper, you know what I mean?
After barbecue, yeah, you know, he had a lot of props with empty pockets. So, you know, we the crew, we want to look good. So, you know, everybody, we petty hustling out there.
We had to eat, so, you know, doing a little drug peddling here, there.
In any ghetto in America, there's usually two things that most young black men aspire to be. It's to be a rapper or to be a hustler of some form.
If you sell crack, you get girls, you're gonna have a bunch of money in your pocket, you get respect.
You almost could not run from it. It was like, oh, I could make $500 in 20 minutes.
You know, we're in the projects, everybody needs fast money, so, you know, Nas sold some crack.
Selling crack on 40th Avenue and Vernon Boulevard. That was the hardest job I ever had.
You know the choices, the chances that if you got knocked up, got killed, got shot, that was part of the game.
It was a summer night, May. It was kind of hot.
Jungle Nas's brother, he was hanging with my brother, and they were hanging on the benches, and my brother was on his bike.
Ill Will was collecting money for a cookout we was going to have the next day.
But he got into altercation with somebody.
And now, you know, we thinking nothing's going to happen or whatever, but the guy got a gun. He got a gun on him, man, you know what I'm saying? So I was like, Ill Will, what's up, man? What you going to do? So Will was like, what? I ain't running from nobody. That was his last words. I'm not running from nobody.
Then one of the dudes pulled out a gun and shot him 3 times in the back.
Then Will looked at me with the wide eyes and just fell. I was like shocked. I just stood still. And the dude that did the shooting turned to me and started squeezing too.
My son Jungle was with him. So Jungle was shot in the leg.
Nas was upstairs in the building, and he, as soon as he heard the shots, he knew that was right where we hung out at.
My brother came home and said, you know, Jabari's been shot. They got Willie.
May 23rd, 1992, Ill Will got killed, yeah.
The neighborhood was shocked.
When they said Will got shot, I was like, nah, not him.
He was like one of our best friends since the beginning of time.
It took a lot out of a lot of people. And I think it took more so a lot out of Nasir because they were like brothers.
When Willie passed, I was afraid of Nasir straying from his path.
His home, here is his close friend and his brother, you know, being shot.
I really expected him to just go straight downhill from there.
Yeah, Will, rest in peace, yo, I'm out. Ill Will, God bless your life.
Nasir's best friend, Willie Grant, wound up getting shot, you know, a best friend of his.
His loss had a profound impact on Nas.
Willie's death easily could have been an excuse for Nasir to just go up the deep end, but I think his death more or less inspired him.
Will was just like, not for Nas.
He decided to distance himself away from anything and everything that was going to keep him from his ultimate goal.
It was either music or I'm going down. It's like after the music, there's no other exit out.
That's when Nas got, you know, real serious with the music.
He was trying to get his record deal, and I know he was trying to make a name for himself.
Every day, we would take the train into Manhattan. We would shop his tapes at Def Jam everywhere.
Yeah.
But no one was really gravitating to the Nas stuff. They were like, get out of here. And, you know, as little kids, we were crushed, devastated, you know? But then MC Search came through.
MC Search was a part of a group called Third Base.
Nas was like, yo, can you help me get my thing, you know, together? And I asked him, well, what do you want? He said, you know, I want it all.
Search saw Nas. Search was like, hey, let's give it a shot.
You could tell Nas had that thing.
This is Nas, kid, you know how it runs.
That's when I went to Faith Newman.
MC Search called me and he said, I have this demo tape.
For you, I got a lot to shoot songs here. My rhymes are hotter than a prostitute. Yeah, yeah.
And he brought it over in my office and I just flipped.
Showed up.
And Faith would not let me leave unless we made a deal.
At the time I signed him, he was 17, just going on 18.
Oh, boy. Huh.
When he got his first record deal, his advance was $17,000. We thought he just hit the lotto. We thought he was rich, word.
The first song that he put out commercially was the song called Halftime from a soundtrack to a movie called Zebrahead. I'm an intellectual, a rap, I'm a
professional, and that's no question, yo. We thought that it would be a good launch to put a Nas track on there.
Nas had the whole package, the way he looked, the way his vocal tone was, his rhyme style was unique. This goes out to Manhattan, the Allen of
Staten, Brooklyn and Queens is living fat. It's just Nas in his rawest form. To the Queensbridge, that record had a huge buzz on the streets.
Just off of the strength of the song Halftime, every major producer at that time in the hip-hop world came to him and wanted to work with him.
Yes. Nas was working on Illmatic at the same time that, you know, Zebrahead was out.
They had Premier, they had Q-Tip, they had Pete Rock, they had Large Professor. I mean, they had the top-of-the-line producers on the album.
To get all of us on one project for one MC, you had to really be special.
Nas spent about a year and a half, 2 years working on the album.
He took so long because he really was trying to put the perfect album together.
There were weeks that would go by when nothing would happen.
He wanted to find the right music, and he wanted to find it at his pace.
He's always afraid that the fans might not like it or he's gonna fail.
There was a tremendous amount of pressure. It was like, speed it up, get it out, quick, you know.
You got this one shot. You're talking from everything you've seen from the beginning to the end, from the womb to the tomb. So he's trying to grab everything he knows and put it in this one album. This is like your last, this is it. Get
down. Illmatic was released April in 1994.
New York was frozen, just like, I mean, cars stopped, just everything. It was just like, Nas. The city never sleeps, full of villains and creeps.
That's where I learned to do my hustle, had to stuff with free. He made 10 songs. He hit 10 home runs. I never sleep, cause sleep
is the cousin of death. He sounded more like a prophet. He was speaking on terms of reality and what he lived in day after day. That all of us in the inner city and the ghetto all across the country could relate to.
The East Coast and all of the other rappers and all the other musicians just stormed to it. And the critical response was incredible.
The buzz is phenomenal. He gets 5 mics in the Source. Now, at this time, no one got 5 mics in the Source.
It meant everything in terms of credibility. They were the single most important magazine in the street at the time. The world is this.
The world is yours. The way people talked about him, other rappers, producers, you know, people was like he was this kind of messiah almost. I mean, he kind of attained like this mythological status.
I mean, yo, he was king of New York. King of New York.
There was mad pressure on Nas. You're the next great rapper. You're it. You know, and people were expecting, like, these phenomenal record sales.
But the sales wasn't there, you know.
It was slow going.
93, 94, those were the years of Snoop and Dre. They were selling 3, 4, 5 million records. Nas was only selling 500,000.
The sales didn't match the hysteria around him and around that album.
To go gold for Illmatic, that was horrible. You know, Illmatic was supposed to go platinum the day it was released.
I mean, if you're a hip-hop purist and you appreciate the lyrics, you couldn't ask for a better album. If you want big pop single, we didn't have that.
Nas always wanted to make sure that he keep his street credibility, but I think the machine was not looking upon the street credibility. They was looking upon the next level and higher.
Nas met Carmen right around the time Illmatic dropped.
They just became an item, and they were just a really cute couple.
Carmen was cool. She always used to hang around. She was the girl who was like the guy in the crew, hanging out with us.
They was in love. Everything looked good back then.
I remember hearing Carmen was pregnant and Nas was gonna have a baby.
Nas was 21 years old when he had his first child. Her name is Destiny. Destiny was adorable as a baby.
He knew it was a responsibility and he was excited about being a dad.
For him, Destiny was like his next step as being a man.
He wanted to provide for Destiny a life and a lifestyle that his family was unable to provide him.
Destiny was everything to him, but he got to get back to business, you know what I'm saying?
He really had to come back with more of a power now. He's watching other rappers like Biggie Smalls, and they're blowing up to the moon.
Here's Nas seeing all this commercial success. Snoop and Dre on the West Coast, Puffy and Biggie on the East Coast. People saying I'm a great MC, but I'm not selling any records, which means I'm not really making the kind of money I should be making.
There was like this kind of pressure on him because he had the talent, he should have the riches like they do.
The label was like, you know what, Nas, we gotta do something to get some sales out here.
Album number two, they said, okay, now we gotta, you know, get into the mainstream aspect, which is when, you know, Lauryn Hill stepped in.
She was just coming off, you know, a huge buzz with the Fugees, and he was coming off a huge buzz, and they both respected each other musically.
In 1996, Nas made a conscious decision that I'm gonna link up with Lauryn, and I'll get on MTV.
The song that he did with Lauryn Hill was a song called If I Rule the World.
It was all over the place, MTV, all video outlets, all radio, pop radio. Just a huge record for Nas.
The second album, it was written, went double platinum off of the strength of the first single, If I Ruled the World. So many years of depression make me vision
the better living, type of place to raise kids in. The sales was incredible. Everybody seen a bigger meal ticket from it. Imagine everybody flashing, fashion,
designer clothes, lacing your click up with diamond rolls. And that's when it happened for him and took off.
That took Nas to a whole nother level. After that, I mean, it was ball game. It was fun time now, you know?
My mother was, she was so happy.
She was proud like a mother, like your son made it.
He finally proved himself to my mother, like he can make it without school.
He was very close with his mother, very, very close, you know? And Nas did a lot of things that I don't even think a lot of rappers did. He moved his moms out the projects before he even bought himself anything.
We used to talk about moving since we was little kids. And she finally got a chance. They was living in the same house. They had a mansion. He had her with him, living with him. Thanksgiving dinners was from projects to mansions, you know?
He turned a very sad situation for her with him not going to school into something that he was able to say, look, maybe I didn't go to school, but I was able to provide for you like I said I was gonna do. And he's proud of that.
To my mom, look at me, baby. I love you, girl.
When It Was Written came out, Nas was definitely at the top of his game.
It Was Written was like his biggest commercial record to date.
He was like, we're making money now, we're finally out the ghetto.
It Was Written came out in July of 1996. And like 2 months later, it was probably the darkest period in hip-hop history.
Around 11:15 in the evening, some 12 shots were fired, four of them striking Tupac Shakur.
At 1:15 a.m., Christopher Wallace, also known as Notorious B.I.G., was pronounced dead of gunshot wounds.
By the time Biggie and Pac got killed, Nas was still only in his mid-20s. You're still trying to figure your stuff out, man. You know, and you see your colleagues blown away.
It makes you think. You know, like, damn, I could be next.
What up, Big? You know, this is rough after you slid. You in God's hands now. Keep a place on me, kid.
When Big and Pop left, it was like a big void.
The logical successor was Nas, but he felt like he had to take a step back.
Nas was able to see that nothing could be as important as staying alive and extracting yourself from the madness.
For a couple years there, it just seemed like he was just kind of floating creatively, artistically, trying to find his voice again. I'm wondering why it's a dirty
game. Is any man worthy of fame? But hip-hop is competitive, and you gotta go with the time.
Every year, it's new artists is coming out.
You know, Puffy was coming out and really dominating the game at that time.
It was all about, you know, the bling-bling phase.
And a lot of artists started to really want to do what Puff was doing, commercializing the music. And I think Nas wanted to take a stab at it, too. Come on.
In 1999, Nas put out I Am and Nostradamus, which weren't two of his best CDs.
I remember seeing the Hate Me Now video, and Nas has got on... He's just like Puffy, basically. Don't hate me. Hate the money I see. Clothes that I buy. Ice that I wear. Clothes that I try. I remember thinking to myself, that's not the Nas that I know. I mean, what is going on here? With he's just
He's just blinging all over the place.
Gucci this, Fendi that. What you expect, yo?
Nas is definitely viewed as like a hip hop artist that spoke about the ills of the street.
And so the streets is like, oh, you know, he sold out basically because it's like, you just made a pop record.
A lot of people were just like, well, that era of him being the greatest MC might be over. Do it now.
Nostradamus was kind of panned by critics. So Jay-Z came along and just went right by him.
So I stretched the game out, etched your name out, the jigger on top.
He comes stepping right in place and people start looking more at Jay-Z.
There was a point in the late 90s when every other song was Jay-Z. It was crazy. H to the Izzo,
B to the Izzo. Jay, for the longest time, was under Nas's shadow. And I think it got to him.
And so what better way to try to raise your own street credibility than to you got this battle going?
It really started from that point that they were just throwing little jabs at each other.
And then before you know it, Jay-Z just keeps punching.
Brooklyn's favorite son, Jay-Z, took a swipe at the pride of Queens, Nas, with the performance of a song called The Takeover during a New York Summer Jam concert.
I remember Jay's lyrics. It kind of went like, Nizzle, I can decide. That's one hot album every 10-year average, and that's so lame.
And the Jay-Z diss came from left field, you know?
Jay had that much power at that time to put Nas into a crunch. I was like, damn, Nas is like damn near over. So poof, bam,
move, son of a... He wasn't even gonna diss Jay-Z back. He was like, I'm bigger than that. Like, I got other real stuff to think about than have a petty battle with you.
Nas and Carmen's relationship was not doing well, as a lot of relationships that start when you're very young.
As Nas' career got bigger, of course, you know, a lot of girls like Nas out of nowhere. There was a lot of cheating and getting caught at hotels. She couldn't handle it, he couldn't handle it.
On top of all of that, there was some rumors about Jay-Z that definitely affected Nas' real personal relationship stuff.
Carmen started dating Jay-Z, and I think that was probably a rough period for him.
Nas's relationship was over.
Then right after that, things really took a turn for the worse. I remember his mother telling Nas and Jabari that she had breast cancer.
He knew she was sick, but he did not know the extent of her sickness.
And hid her diagnosis from a lot of people.
She's not the kind of person who won't drop it on anybody.
I just remembered her during that whole period of time constantly encouraging him to work hard and, you know, not to worry about her.
You know, you're in a career and you're in a business where you gotta just stay focused.
He was really focusing on the music real hard, like on coming back real strong.
He knew that he had to do that for her.
Nas was at a turning point in his career. You know, he was on the ropes thinking about, I'm about to lose a mother, while Jay-Z's attacking him potentially could end his whole career.
I saw Nas and he said, yo, I'm gonna get him. And I was like, I don't know if you're gonna pull this one off, G. You really need to get back on point with the way you was back in the early days.
He voiced through the pen, you know? He just went back and voiced through the pen.
Jay put a fire under Nas. It made him wake up and realize that his audience needs him to be the MC they always knew he was.
Brace yourself for the main event. Y'all impatiently waiting.
In December of 2001, Stillmatic was released. The track Ether put to rest all of that beef between him and Jay and basically set the story straight.
Nas came back at him and he spoke his mind.
Heard it when I was asleep that this Jay-Z and Rockefeller Records wanted beef.
Nas was never tested on a battle before, so no one knew how ferocious the bite or the growl could get.
You a fan, a phony, a fake, a fuck you stand, I still with you.
I knew that eventually people want to hear what I gotta say. There is no takeover.
Check it out, I just sold like Ether. Well, teach you the king, you know you. Nas son across the belly. Lose. I prove you lost already.
On the streets, phones was ringing. There's people that didn't even have cell phones that was on the phone just to say, did you hear this record?
Were you abused as a child, scared to smile, they called you ugly?
That Ether was a brutal knockout punch. That was that.
Ugh. He's down!
Nas won, and that was what brought him back to the game. He won. He beat Jay-Z. That's the truth.
I think Nas probably silenced every critic he ever had.
It resurrected Nas' career in a major way.
Stillmatic put him back in his proper perspective to get the street credibility back.
You could see that he had changed. He had gone through a transformation. Oh, yeah.
wasn't about getting airplay. It was about, yo, I'm Nas, dog. Like, for real. Like, I'm Nas. Like, don't forget who I am.
With all the success of Stillmatic, people say Nas is back, you know, he's regained his crown, all of that. It couldn't hide the problems at home, you know, specifically his mom's being sick.
We was on a road, then somebody called us and told us my mother, an ambulance had to get her, and she was real sick.
Nas had to leave the tour to come home because his mom was in the hospital.
We went straight to New York Hospital, and the doctor was like, yo, she don't got but a week or 2 weeks. That was like, you know, a cannon to the head, you know what I'm saying? That was like unbelievable.
I think the biggest thing was he had to sit back and just wait for nature to take its course with his mother.
Nas was at his mother's bedside that whole last week, probably almost every night. He had just packed a bag and camped out. He would spend the night and just sit there and, you know, read or do whatever he had to do. It's hard because it's hard to...
The pain, watching my mother in that much pain was, that was the craziest I've ever been through in my whole entire life. Like, you know.
Nas' mother Ann passed April
7, 2002. Nas was there when she passed away. He had called out to her, and she opened her eyes again, and then she took her last breath. She died in his arms.
The pain he felt is unexplainable. She died, passed away, believing in him and his brother. So now it's like, I want to make everything that she ever dreamed of in me all come through. Come through.
Nas was very much, you know, devastated when his mom's passed.
He kind of lost himself in his work after that. After the funeral and everything, then he went out on tour. He was still kind of riding on the success of Stillmatic during that time.
He had no choice but to go on because she invested way too much for him to allow passing to stop him.
He went on the road, trying to keep her busy. He was hurting. He was hurting through it every day, you know. He was definitely in that zone of what he wanted to speak about and tell the world about, you know, his moms and how he felt.
Godson was released in December of 2002.
Nas dedicated Godson to his mother.
I had to finish up another album because if I wouldn't have, she'd be mad at me from up there and saying, you know, that's not how I raised you.
Everything in that album was almost like, Mom, I did it, you know?
I could just tell he was pouring all of his feelings into that CD. Everything that he was going through as far as his mother's death was in that CD.
I dream of the day I can go back to when I was born, laying in your arms, wishing you was here today, Mom.
It was a song on that album, Dance, and it was dedicated to his mom.
April 7, 2002, that's when the gates of heaven opened up for you to stroll through, beautiful Ann Jones.
It just reminds me of their relationship and how close they were and, you know, how much he really, really, truly loved her and how much he misses her.
I can't even hear that. I'll never listen to that. Every time I come on, I feel like I feel now. I gotta leave. I can't even hear it. It's too deep. You know what I'm saying?
I knew that he missed his mother. I knew there was a void in his life, you know?
Nas never really had a strong relationship with his dad.
When my father left the house, Nas was mad. You know, we was both little kids.
Nas's mother would always tell him, you know, this is your father. He's all you have.
She always wanted us to love him and respect him, no matter what he did. She didn't want us to turn our backs on him.
See, I come from Mississippi.
He told me he was going to do a record with his father.
Nas's father, great blues musician Oludar, represent Mississippi and Harlem, you know what I'm saying?
He had a desire to build a relationship with his father that he lost for many years.
I named the boy Nas.
All the boys call him Nas.
I think with the song Bridging the Gap, Nas and his dad are able to mend a lot of old wounds and connect in a lot of ways.
Let's go.
He collaborating with his pops, that was excellent.
To do it with your pops, that's a ill thing.
Told him as a youngster, he'll be the greatest man alive. You're the greatest pop.
That song specifically connects to a bond between musical legacies.
One of the great hip-hop moments of the last year or so, October 1st, 2004, VH1 Hip Hop Honors Awards.
I'm gonna bring my man out and he rocking with his pop. Give it up and make some noise for my brother from another mother. Nas! Let's go! What's up, New York?
When I saw him and Olu, I was amazed, like my mouth dropped open.
Bridging the gap, blues, jazz, rap. The history of music on this track. Born in the game.
The way they was looking at each other was like, you know, it was special, you know, it was like, you can't get that, you ain't gonna get that nowhere, cause it's like, father and son, they just was, you know, look, go ahead, son, yeah, you do your thing.
What you tell me, Dad?
The greatest man alive.
He said it, y'all.
You definitely see the ease in Nasir's face.
You can see that he was happy to be with his father like that.
Peace, I love y'all.
Nas's mother, if she was alive now, she'd be very proud.
Just to see Nas get closer to his father, something that she knew that Nas didn't have as a child.
She's not here, God bless her, but I know she was upstairs watching.
Nothing gonna stop me now.
When you look at where Nas started 10 years ago with Illmatic, you realize, man, this dude's been through a lot. You know, he's lost a lot of people in his life. Will, his homeboy, his moms.
He's been able to overcome all of that and put a lot of that in his music.
He's a listener. He's an observer. So these things, he knows how to piece his life together.
He was destined to be who he is, man, because his soul was strong.
This is my hood. I'm a rap to the death of it.
Being kind of in the situation you are in Queensbridge Projects and Queens, to being one of the most respected artists in the world, Nas ranks in the most esteemed echelon, the icon class.
If you really think you're ready to fly with my power, this is what Nas is about, brothers. The time is now.
Nas has been doing this strictly as an MC. That's rare. He ain't acting. He's not a radio personality. He doesn't have a clothing line. You know, he's got one mic. That's his legacy. He's got one mic and he's been using it.